So Pradeep, it's very interesting. You are in the concept of the rural development of India. What inspired you to get into this activity as a social entrepreneurship? It's not an NGO. It's a social enterprise where his objective is to make profits, at the same time add value to the lives of people who are not observed majorly by corporates in a very positive way. Because when we talk about a village, a lot of negative things come up in our minds. So what made you get into this activity?
No. First of all, I've taken a less tribal path because I was not having education, a family background, a money. So what I was having is only enthusiasm and energy. So, and that's why I've taken a less tribal path. And in 1993, there was a buzz, even today, go to rural India, there is a business.
Okay. And what has been your experience in the last two decades, in the last 20 years? Have you seen the shift of the corporates defocusing from the cities and more focusing towards the villages?
Not defocusing, but they are not defocusing from the cities, but definitely they are focusing the rural India. And you take any product of this country, any concept, any communication, whatever you have, everybody is concentrating on rural India, because you take any segment, there is a more market share than urban India.
So you create a bridge between the villages and the corporate India. When you talk about corporate India, then you are talking about the cities. So are you creating a bridge between these two?
Yes, because we understand the language of corporate and we understand the language of last man. So we are the bridge between both of them.
So what is the kind of network that you have built to make all this happen? What is the kind of network that is there at the disposal?
Yeah, we have created one concept called no need to go to all the villages of the country. Go to the villages having population about 2000 and where weekly bazaar takes place. If you are strong in these villages, you are ultimately strong in most of the villages of this country. And then we have started collecting data of these villages. You can say it's a kundali of that village, which will be used by a professional company as well as a social entrepreneurs.
Pradeep, you heard the profiles of majority of the people sitting in this hall. What do you feel can be done by these entrepreneurs as a business opportunity in the villages? What is that you feel is lacking in the villages, which is a underlying business opportunity that you can feel about?
No. Don't take otherwise. But first, change the perception looking at rural India is the first step. Because what we think, whenever we think of rural India, we think that nobody is staying there, they don't have a money, they don't have a purchase power, will they buy my product, will they buy my concept, communication. First, we have to think that, you have to change our perception, and then there is a lot of opportunities. And that's what I've told you, you take any segment, there is a more market share, including financial sector. It is a more market share in rural India than urban India. So there is huge opportunity, because communication is reaching to practically every Indian. Practically every Indian. There are five major changes which are happening in this country, and one of them is education. It is making a huge change. Means we are the largest elementary education system in the world. Out of 198 people doesn't know this. So this is the problem. And out of that 98%, 68% study in rural India. So there is an opportunity.
How do you change the mindset of the people in the village? You need to also change the mindset of the people in the urban cities. Only then the marriage can happen. So how do you currently do it with the villages?
No.
What is your mind change process that you are adapting
to? No, it is happening. It is not me. When any foreign agency says, we accept that. That is our another problem. Anyway, having said that, the biggest change which is happening because of education and communication, now everybody knows that, yes, I know there is a rural India. The changes are happening. For an example, if you take Maharashtra, more Mercedes sales in Kolhapur. And not in Pune. More BMW sales in Aurangabad and not in Pune. So that change has already come in. So you have to catch that. But one thing is very clear. When you think of rural India, it is not an overnight story. There should be some consistency in it. And you should be very clear where I am going. For an example, as you have mentioned, we have 6,38,000 villages. Only 6,000 tehsils and block, and only 600 districts. Whatever happening in this country is happening in 600 districts. But above that, there are 6,000 tehsils, and above that, there are 6 lakh villages. And even by 2050, 50% people will stay in rural India.
Okay.
So there is a huge opportunity.
So the villages are not coming to the urban cities. The urban cities, people have to go there and create establishment and business opportunities is your feeler?
Yeah, because now you see what you require when you want to go to rural India is infrastructure, roads, communication. It is happening. Just 18 years back, there are around 2,38,000 villages where there was no all-season road. There now in India only, actually I put it this way, there are 5 lakh villages where there is a all-season road. So you can go there. communication is reaching to 92% population of India. Satellite TV is reaching to 65% population of India. And the biggest revolution which is happening in this country is DTH. Every month, there is a 5 lakh installation of DTH in rural India. If DTH is happening in his house, means that household is connected to the world. You cannot stop him. He can see even bold and beautiful.
Fantastic. I'm sure Ratish and Vivek will be happy with this information. We're already seeing smiles because they want their music to reach every house of the country. So the connectivity is happening. And once you penetrate into these houses through technology, through communication, then business communication can happen, opportunities communication can happen, education communication can happen. How receptive are the villages for this to happen? How receptive are they?
No, now they are changing in a big way. Previously, he used to invest only in two things, that is gold and land. Today, he's investing in everything. He's investing in shampoo. He's investing in haversacks. He's buying a shoes. You name it, they are buying it. The biggest issue is branded product reaching there? Because who is overpowering branded product is the duplicate products. In this country, a duplicate product market is 15,000 crore rupees. Means he's inspired. He wants to buy. But most of the time, major companies are reaching there. But now, as I've told you earlier, that 2000 and above, you name any big company, they have already targeted that villages. They have a distribution system intact. They have a different distribution channel for urban India and a different distribution channel for rural India. So either you can ride on that or the road, I mean that highway is already there, just you have to walk on that.
We had a mindset, Pradeep, wherein every guy from the city wanted to go to the United States, to UK and to Dubai. Okay, and every villager wanted to come to Pune or to Mumbai. So what shift do you see in that thought process? What shift do you see in that mindset?
No, it will change. You cannot change that mindset, but let me tell you how it is happening. Now, as we all look at US as our role model, they are looking at us. Means ultimately, they are also looking at Western countries. It is happening that way. But what is happening is, now a lot of youth are going back to square one, and that square one is agriculture. And it is changing. In a big way, it is changing. Because I'll give you just one example, if you'll permit me. There is one exhibition which happens in Pune called Kisan Exhibition. In that exhibition, if you want to come, you have to pay 50 rupees. It is not a mela. You have to pay 50. You have to come on your own. And 130,000 youth visit that exhibition. It is purely agri exhibition. And out of that, 67% are educated. And out of that, 47% have visited Israel. So it's a huge change. It's a huge change which is happening in this country. What we have to, you actually should call one of them to this platform. Look, he is from a village, but one of the person around Pune, just 3 months back, bought one Rolls Royce. And he has posted that on Facebook and all that, WhatsApp and all that. But he has written one very nice sentence below that. I have bought this Rolls Royce not selling my land, but earning from my land.
Fantastic.
So that change has already started coming in a big way.
No, I can see what agriculture can do. In fact, a dear friend of mine sitting in this hall, Gregory D'Souza, has only 11 acres of land outside Palghar. But that land is worth seeing. That land produces so much that his factory people are eating out of that whatever is grown there. His house eats from whatever is grown there. My house eats from whatever is grown there. And our chairman's house eats from whatever is grown there. And it is still surplus. And he keeps on looking out for people whom he can give it furthermore. You get me? Very soon all these houses will be eating from that one farm. When you see that kind of wealth happening, we understand the power of farming. What do you think can enrich our villagers to become more productive per acre? Like when you see in Israel, Israel produces what Israel produces in 1 acre, India produces the same quantum in 30 acres of land.
I agree. But there is an issue. Please don't compare Israel with India. That is one thing. Because they have a different mindset, we have a different mindset. We are blessed. We are blessed, so we are lazy. Because we have 4 seasons. Yes, accept the fact. Because we have 4 seasons. We get rain, we get God, that sun, we get winter, we get everything. So this is an issue. Let me tell you, I'll put it this way. Now, how it is changing, as I've told you, when you get money, it is the driving force. And the driving force is earning money and dignity. The biggest issue, and we should be blamed for that, urbanite, we should give a dignity to the farmer. Unless and until we will not give dignity to the farmer, that profession is not going to. For an example, now you all are educated. How many of you have studied the agriculture? Only one, two, three. Means what? Because there is no subject in our study as an agriculture. So how you will respect? When I ask my daughter or my, from where we get the milk, she says from the
Dudhwala.
Dudhwala. So sad. Lot of people doesn't know where come the mungfali. Upar aati hai ke niche. Nobody knows. It's a huge problem. So there is no dignity. And that is a problem. But as I've told you, the change is now he has realized previously the youth of rural India is to think of two things only. One, either he'll become a PI or he'll become a MLA. But today he has realized that is not possible. And the third option was, I'll try and get a job in government. But now he has realized because there is no job in government, everybody cannot be a PI, you cannot be an MLA unless and until you have tons blessings. Of money. So he is going back to that square one, and that is agriculture. Now I'll give an example of a district called Usmanabad, which is comparatively drought district of Maharashtra. In index of Maharashtra, it probably 23, 24 out of 36. But in that Usmanabad district, there are few farmers who are producing strawberries. And they are sending it to the London. That is the case studies we should blow up in a big way. Then the youth will come in this business. And we have to look farming as a business and not just it is my father's burden on me, so I'll do it.
Fantastic, fantastic. I think that says a lot. But what I feel is as entrepreneurs will always travel to where there is an opportunity to multiply their wealth.
Correct.